Hello. Today I want to make a few points. I want to make a few points because right now our whole country's into a quagmire of war, crime, you name it, we got it. And I want to avoid people from hurting someone else or getting hurt by misinterpreting facts because they don't really know what's going on or all the involvement and stuff. So what I'm talking about is, because right now the war in Israel, you have factions pro and against. That's your choice. I'm not talking about that. What I'm talking about is criminals here, global USA criminals that kill people, rob people, hurt people. They always find a way to make money out of disasters, bad things, and I imagine that's going to start happening soon. We've already had murders in France, and people killed a couple teachers with a knife, and that sort of thing. And that's a couple days ago. I hadn't really watched the news the last couple of days. So that could come, but very unlikely, and especially here. Because me and Jason Aldean, we both come from small towns. But other towns, Chicago, San Francisco, Dallas, New Orleans, you may have a little more trouble because that's where a lot of people are coming across the border. And they're shipped everywhere, so they could be in your neighborhood. Don't discount that they aren't, but don't think that they are. If something happens, you be an observer, you be a witness. If you're in a position where you help somebody, you may do that. But most people that I know, my family and my friends, don't know what an accent or how people dress from that area would look like. So if you see somebody different, don't assume that's who they are. Because a lot of people have that skin tone. They could be like some people. Like, I was a cop in Colorado and other places, and some people you think are this and they're not. So unless you're an expert and a well-traveled person, you really don't know what you're looking at. Now, you know if the accent sounds different, that they may not be from your neighborhood. And even if they aren't from your neighborhood, that doesn't mean that they're involved in the war at all, or with the criminals, or take advantage of this one way or another. Now, if you want to feel safer, you might just make good preparations. If you have an alarm, keep it on. If you have defensive weapons, make sure they've been cleaned and are operating, and go and shoot them. Most of the time, you'll just have fun shooting, because you're not going to have that problem most places in the country. But if you do, it's good to be prepared. It's like if you buy a new motorcycle. You might get home, your wife will think it's just lovely, but more than likely, you're going to get a boot stuck up your butt. So don't assume you know what's going to happen, because that never ever works out. That's why they have divorce attorneys. I'm just telling you. But don't have that false expectations, because this is a dangerous circumstance in some scenarios. Let me give you one for example. Say that all of a sudden in your state, they're getting conflict like over in France, and it might get more conflict as it goes along. And all of a sudden, crimes happen in your neighborhood. And you just happen to be looking down the street, and you see some people coming, and you're saying to yourself, they might be for that area. But you don't know. They don't look the same, they don't dress the same. And they could be from that area, and they could have been from that area for the last 20 years. So don't make any assumptions. Now, what to look for, and you may have something to worry about, whether it's a criminal or someone from another country, is if you see people stopping down the street that you've never seen that car before, then you see people get out of that car you've never seen before. So far, you're just a little suspicious, but no problem. But then you open the trunk and they all get an AR and start walking your way. Now you may really be suspicious. Who may they be? Number one, in that circumstance, the most highly unlikable probability is they're law enforcement going to enforce an arrest warrant. That's what they do. Show up, get your guns out, and go to the suspect's house. So if you see people with guns, don't assume that they're from some other place or they're bad guys. They could be undercover cops. That's the most likely what you'll see in most neighborhoods. Especially in places like Chicago and Houston and New York and that sort of thing. Because they do a lot of warrants, you know, drugs, robberies, all that sort of thing. But watch. Now you might see details where it tells you they're not cops. About what they're carrying. You know, cops look more professional when they're carrying a gun. They got a sling in the proper position. You know, usually they'll have a jacket or, you know, a short sleeve shirt on, and they have, you know, NYPD on the back or whatever, LAPD. So watch for all the details before you start calling the cops. But if you get to the point where you think they are suspicious, call the police. And be, when you're being describing a suspect, what you want to describe is something that they will understand. People in Texas and you're describing somebody from the Middle East and you're knowledgeable about that, they may not understand what you're saying because you're not used to their address or their culture. So just describe what you know from your knowledge base. Don't make up stuff and act like you know what you're talking about when you don't. You might say something like, there's four men out there. Tall one, about 6'2", the shortest one's maybe 5'9". They all have guns, and they're all wearing the same vest, and they're from this address. And they all look like they're clean shaved. There's a couple of them that are blonde and thin, and there's a couple of them that are heavy and have red hair. So you're being real descriptive. So when they pull up, they know what to look for. You know, and if something really unusual in the description, you might say, well, one has a rainbow hat, and the other one has shorts on, and the other two have long trousers. The more details when they get there, the more confident they'll be. Those are the people you think are suspicious. At that point, if they have AR-15s, other cops come, and they get out of their car, they're not suspicious. Because the cops not going to pull up, look down the street, and see four guys with an AR, and just walk up to them. That's not going to happen. They're going to get behind cover and tell them to drop the guns. If they don't know who they are, or not dressed properly for that area, as far as being a law enforcement officer, then they're going to react that way because they don't know who they are either. That's why the most descriptive thing that you can give them, especially anything odd that jumps out, that'd be fine. Because bad stuff happens. I don't like telling this story because I have a real personal connection to this person. Watched him grow up as a kid. And he was out, this is in out west, I'll say that. I don't like talking about too much because the family, we all know that family. A guy gets out and starts doing a mass shooting. The kid I'm talking about, who I'm not going to tell you his name, pulled out his pistol, cleared the scene by eliminating the threat. Made the mistake of picking up the shotgun that the mass shooter had just as the cop comes around the corner. He got a call, there's a guy with a gun shooting people with a shotgun. They come around the corner, they see a guy with a gun with a shotgun because he just picked it up. He's probably thinking, well, I'm the good guy and I saved everybody. But the cop that sees that, and there's other people still there, so he's an immediate threat to the whole crowd, gets out. And I wasn't there for the whole details, but he ended up getting shot. Because he's holding the shotgun, which the call was all about, the guy with the shotgun. So, what I'm telling you now, if you do see somebody like that, you see him shooting, don't go out on your porch with a rifle in your hand. Because the cop pulls up, he's evaluating everything they can see, which you always can't depend on the witness if they're giving you an accurate description. But they did say rifle or shotgun, and And he pulls up and there's a couple people in your yard because maybe you shot those two people because they saw you were shooting at you. And they're gonna, if they see you, they're going to shoot you. If they see one of your neighbors down there with a gun, they might shoot him. So if you pick up a gun, which you shouldn't do, because you come into in a situation, scenario that from a distance, that's what most logical people will think. Even though you're a good guy, you could be the dead guy. So if you're going to help, and you're pretty sure it's the cops, because the other guys are now exchanging fire with their back to you, if you can slide the windows open just so they don't know where it comes from, because shots are going off, you pop off, a couple bad guys keep ducking back, they don't know where it's coming from. And if you, even if you shot by their feet, they're going to turn around and see what's going on, distract them from shooting at the cops, and you can save some lives, but in general, it's better to stay out of it. But if it looks like you can help them and you're in the house where it's a little safer, that's up to you. So, but remember, most cases, most calls, because everybody right now is hyper, there's not going to be somebody that came here or lives here that is trying to kill somebody because they're from that particular area where the war is at. That should be your last decision that you think they are under these circumstances. Now, like I say, if you start getting shots around the neighborhood and every other day and stuff like that, then you might have to get your food, get everybody back in the house where it's safe, or if you have the option, leave the area. You don't want to be involved. Now, if you have guns to defend yourself and you can't leave, then that's what you do. But you want to be in the hardest place for bullets to come through your walls and hit you. If you have an underground basement, that's the best place because you're below, when the bullets are going through, they'll be going over you or whatever. These walls won't stop powerful rifles. Now, you might say, well, I don't have an AR. Well, if you don't have an AR, what do you have? A friend of mine, his name was Cotton Gordon. You can look him up. One of the best Africa hunting guides there was at the time I knew him when he was still living. And one day I asked him, because I've been to Africa a few times myself, I said, what's the best gun to have for a lion that's charging you? And he replied, the one in your hand. This is the same scenario. You have a hunting rifle, but don't have an AR? The hunting rifle is your weapon. Hunting rifle, powerful, accurate. You can't shoot 30 rounds a minute, but you can shoot 30 rounds and kill for 30 people. It just takes you longer, that's all. So, remember that. People show up next week and you didn't buy a rifle or don't have one, or it's at your other house or your dad's house. If you got any gun at all, that's the best one to have in your hand. So remember that. If you go to buy a gun and you're not a gun person, don't spend a fortune on a brand new gun. Go buy a used gun. If the gun's traded in, they will have their gunsmith go through it and it will function. I've never had one bought used that didn't function properly. I could just be lucky. But if you want to go get a gun that you're more familiar with, whether it's a handgun, a rifle, or a shotgun. In this particular circumstance, a shotgun would be the most versatile because you can put slugs in it and still shoot at 50 yards. Or you could put double up buckshot, have a lot of pellets coming out, which has a lot of power, drop people quickly, and at close range, not too many people will survive it. Probably zero. They catch them in the chest. So if you go buy one, buy the cheapest one you can get, an older one like an SKS. I got one in Colorado for $88 25 years ago. It's the gun they made before they made the AK-47. This was made during the Korean War in the 50s, the SKS. And if you get a gun like that for $100, and if everything calms down and goes back to normal and you don't like guns, you can sell it to somebody else. But at least you'll have something to protect yourself. Okay, there's two ways to win a fight. The best way is don't be there when the fight starts. But if you're stupid like you occasionally are, I'm an expert at, and you're still home, then you gotta use what you got. If you don't have a gun, you have to go to knives, machetes, axes, whatever it takes. A gasoline can with a match, throw it on top of them, throw a match or cigarette. You have to be inventive. You have to be creative, smart, and you have to be what most women don't like you to be, is that toxic male. Kick some butt, go home. But basically, I just wanted to tell you, be aware that most things that you're going to see is probably going to be criminals if you're in a criminal area. If you live out in the country, that probably won't change too much, but you never know. Keep your eyes open. And if you make any preparations, even if it's a 22, anything's better than nothing. And if that's not the case, just stay aware. And as soon as stuff starts, if it does start, and you hear it's down the other end of town, because me and Jason all day are playing our guitars, and I forgot to call you, get out of town. Don't turn around. Don't stop. Okay? And the most, like when you see these mass shootings, then you'll see all the victims. You know the victims you don't see? First shot rings out, here's why. 100-yard dash. Don't be the person that comes out when there's mass shootings. What's going on out here? No. Don't be that dumbass. All right, that's all I wanted to get to you. Everything's going to be fine, but if you prepare, it's even finer. Okay? And when I say preparedness, I mean visual, being observant, stuff like that. And if you can make sure your batteries are good in your alarm, you have flashlights ready, stuff like that. Because you can always use flashlights, all the stuff I'm talking about, during snowstorms and other bad events. And, you know, people other than, in the worst circumstance, just plain old criminals that want to break in. And they come in twos and threes these days and fours, and they mostly have rifles today. So the better you're prepared, the better you are if something does happen. Even though mathematically the odds are slim and almost none. Better to be prepared. Like I said, the best way to win the fight, don't be there. Get your butt gone. Move it. That's what it had been.